भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम्। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुदीनतारिणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीचैतन्यमीश्वरं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं सागरजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवम् साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितंश्च। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामीनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वंशाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। So starting from Srimad Bhagavatam 10th canto 6th chapter verse number 35 and 36 we will take together. So probably we will recite 35th only. Putana Loka Balagni Rakshasi रुधिराशना जीघांसयापी हरये स्तनं दत्वाप सद्गतिं। पूतनालोकबालघ्नी राक्षसी रुधिराशना जिघांसयापि हरये स्तनम् दत्वाप सद्गतिम्। पूतनालोकबालघ्नी राक्षसी रुधिराशना जिघांसयापि हरये स्तनं दत्वाप सद्गतिम्। पूतनालोकबालघ्नी राक्षसी रुधिराशना जिघांसयापि हरये स्तनं दत्वाव सद्गतिम्। पूतनालोकबा राक्षसी रुधिराशना जीघांसयापि हरये स्तनं दत्वाप सद्गतिम्। పూతనాలోక బాలగ్ని రాక్షసీ రుధిరాశనా జుగాంసయాపి హరయే స్తనం దత్వాప సద్గతిం. మాతాజీ, పూతనాలోక బాలగ్ని రాక్షసీ రుధిరాశనా జిహాంసయాపి హరయే స్తనం దత్వాప సద్గతిం. సో ఐల్ రీడ్ ద 36th వర్స్ ఆల్సో. కిం పునః శ్రద్ధయా భక్త్యా కృష్ణాయ పరమాత్మనే యచ్ఛన్ ప్రియతమం కిం అనురక్తాస్తన్మాతరో యథా. రీడ్ వర్డ్ టు వర్డ్ ట్రాన్స్లేషన్. పూతనా, పూతనా ద ప్రొఫెషనల్ రాక్షసి, లోక బాలఘ్ని హు యూస్ టు కిల్ హ్యూమన్ చిల్డ్రన్, రాక్షసి ద షీ డిమన్, రుధిర ఆసనా, రుధిర అశనా, సారీ, సింప్లీ హ్యాంకరింగ్ ఫర్ బ్లడ్, జిఘాం సయా విత్ ద డిజైర్ టు కిల్ కృష్ణ, బీయింగ్ ఎన్వియస్ ఆఫ్ కృష్ణ అండ్ హ్యావింగ్ బీన్ ఇన్స్ట్రక్టెడ్ బై కంస. అపి స్టిల్ హరయే అన్ టు ద సుప్రీం పర్సనాలిటీ ఆఫ్ గాడ్ హెడ్ స్తనం హర్ బ్రెస్ట్ దత్వా ఆఫ్టర్ ఆఫరింగ్ ఆప్ obtained sadgatim, the most elevated position of spiritual existence. Kim, what to speak of? Puna, again, shraddhaya, with faith, bhaktya, by devotion, krishnaya, unto Lord Krishna, paramatmane, who is the supreme person, యచ్ఛన్ ఆఫరింగ్ ప్రియతమం ద డియర్ మోస్ట్ కిం సంథింగ్ ను ఇండీడ్ రక్తాః దోజ్ హూ హ్యావ్ ఎన్ అఫినిటీ తత్ తన్ మాతరః కృష్ణాస్ అఫెక్షనేట్ మదర్స్ ఆఫరింగ్ ద బిలవెడ్ చైల్డ్ దర్ బ్రెస్ట్ యథా. Exactly like. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Putana was always hankering for blood of human children, and with that desire she came to kill Krishna. But because she offered her breast to the Lord, she attained the greatest achievement. What then is to be said of those who had natural devotion and affection for Krishna as mothers, and who offered Him their breast to suck, or offered something very dear as a mother offers something to a child. Purport. Putana had no affection for Krishna. Rather, she was envious and wanted to kill him. Nonetheless, because with or without knowledge she offered her breast, she attained the highest achievement in life. But the offerings of devotees attracted to Krishna in parental love are always sincere. But the offerings of the devotees attracted to Krishna in parental love are always sincere. A mother likes to offer something to her child with affection and love. There is no question of envy. So here we can make a comparative study. If Putana could attain such an exalted position in spiritual life by neglectfully, enviously making an offering to Krishna, what is to be said of Mother Yashoda and other gopis who served Krishna with such great affection and love, offering everything for Krishna's satisfaction? The gopis automatically achieved the highest perfection. Therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu recommended the affection of the gopis, either in the maternal affection or in conjugal love, as the highest perfection in life. Ramya kachid upasana vraja vadhu vargenaya kalpita. So, again, a very First of all, before I begin anything, there are many, many respectable devotees sitting here. I would like to humbly beg their blessings before I could start. So again, this is like we all know the difference between various literatures like Mahabharata and literatures like Bhagavatam. Like when I first in my life read Mahabharata, my immediate impression about Mahabharata was that this scripture is so impartial. Often people who read Mahabharata and comment on Mahabharata, you know, they say that it's completely partial towards Pandavas. You know, Pandavas have been, and so they have to write artificially a commentary defying the original substance, and they write, you know, they make someone else as heroes and whatever. But my first impression when I read Mahabharata literature, I felt that this scripture is absolutely impartial. There are so many places in Mahabharata where Vyasadeva actually glorifies some good qualities in Duryodhana also. If you read the, undoubtedly, you know, Karna is undoubtedly declared as a villain in Mahabharata because of his audacity, his arrogance and so many qualities. But if you read the section of Karna's death, the way Vyasadeva depicts it, the way his head laid there on the ground, it actually invokes a kind of Karuna in the heart of any person. Because he is absolutely impartial. At the same time, he also disapproves certain statements and behaviors of Yudhishthira Maharaj. Yudhishthira Maharaj does something and Vyasadeva completely disapproves it. You know, he doesn't like it. So, you know, I was hearing one lecture of Radhana Swami Maharaj, he was actually giving here, and he said, you know, people, they say that you should be very objective, you know. You know, I want an objective comparison. You know, sometimes people are arguing on some topics and he says, you know, these arguments are all subjective. But I am looking for something objective. You know. And Radhana Maharaj was saying, but how can you be truly objective? He said, as living entities, we are tatastha shakti. That means we are always subjected. We are subjected by either yoga maya or mahamaya. So by constitutional nature, we are subjects. So how can we be objective? It is not possible. But when Vyasadeva is writing something, you know, he is supreme person, he is the incarnation of Supreme Lord. He can be fully objective if he wants to be. Right? Because he is not controlled by three modes of material nature. You know, he is a literary incarnation. He can be truly, perfectly objective. So he writes, when he writes a scripture, he can be as objective as anybody else. And therefore we see Mahabharata. However, literatures like Bhagavatam and Ramayana, you see the speaker gets involved in the story. He tries to be objective, but he also gets involved in the story. So here we are seeing that Shukadeva Goswami narrating this wonderful incident of Putana being killed. And he's saying, okay, you know, Nanda Maharaj was outside. So Nanda Maharaj, by the time Nanda Maharaj came to Vraj, he understood that, okay, Putana has been killed. And you know, what a mess happened in my absence. So Nanda Maharaj and all the senior Vrajavasis, they cut the body of Putana. Then they put the body into fire, and as soon as her body was lit into fire, the smell of Oguru, of course, in Bombay we don't know so many different, we know brute and poison and such type of things, but in Vedic culture there is Oguru, I mean it's a wonderful scent. So the smell of Oguru started spreading all in the environment. And immediately as soon as Shukadeva Goswami speaks that, you know, he can't afford to get not involved in the pastime. All his transcendental emotions, which, you know, as he's approaching 10th chapter, definitely, you know, you can imagine somebody who has been a parrot of Krishna in the spiritual world, you know, he's taken an incarnation and he's going to glorify Krishna. No, it's like, you see, for a devotee who likes to talk, you know, like Prahalad Maharaj, for example, you know, Prahalad Maharaj was sitting in the class, you know, and everything was happening very nicely, you know, children were playing. Prahlad Maharaj also, you know, he was absorbed in his own thing. But, you know, suddenly all these demons, children of demons, they came to Prahlad Maharaj. So they said, you know, Prahlad Maharaj, you know, why are you not playing like us? You know, that was the biggest mistake. You know, you go to a devotee, yeah, and suddenly devotee is sitting in the hotel, he is eating something nice. Suddenly some person goes, you know, why are you not eating onion garlic? That is a mistake. That you give a key to a devotee, you trigger him, and then next 1 hour he is going to give a discourse to you. Then Prahlad Maharaj started, full on. They made a mistake. He just started, and then Shandan Amarkar realized, oh my God, this boy is, you know, we can't keep him in the school. So like that, Shukadeva Goswami also, you know, he gets a trigger somewhere, you know, he gets So that is the trigger, you know, Putana's body, you know, that became, so he is like, wow. So he immediately keeps the story aside and then starts, next three verses, one, two, three, four, six verses, he simply glorifies the paternal affection of gopis, keeps the story aside. He just gets so involved and just glorifying pattern. And amazing thing is, all his emotions are coming out, he's putting them in this literature, in Bhagavatam. And Vyasdev, who is an objective person, he's supposed to, you know, be objectively doing things, he doesn't filter it out. He puts it in the Bhagavatam. For example, you know, I know one devotee. He writes nice articles. So once he wrote a very nice article on Srila Prabhupada, really putting his genuine feelings. That when I read the article, it was wonderful. I said, Prabhuji, this article must be given to BTG, you know. We have to send it. So, you know, that time he did not have email and access. Somehow I had it, so we sent it to BTG. And then after some time, the mail came from the editor. He said, the article is very nice, but it's a very nice article for a local Vyas Puja offering. You know, we can't really put it in the BTG, as in, because, and then there was a justification on how this emotion should be edited and all that. Right? So, something that is supposed to be a face of a movement, you know, that is, you know, there are certain things, even in our Vyas Puja offering also, you know, we don't directly, we say, please send it to us, and then, you know, some editing may be required. Because there are, so certain things that are really coming as emotions, they could be edited. When something is supposed to be put in front of public, you know, you cannot put all the expressions and emotions in front of the public. And this is a literature which is going to be in front of public for next 10,000 years. But Vyasa is not editing it. He is not saying, okay, now these three verses, they are completely out of context. The burning of Putana's body is going on and the Guru sent and all that is happening. Why suddenly gopis are being glorified here? Why suddenly the matter of, keep it aside? No. He's putting that here. No. So he's, and the amazing thing about, so one amazing thing is that Vyasdev is not editing it out. And another amazing thing which I felt, and maybe I am wrong, the same Shukadeva Goswami is now here glorifying so much the maternal affection, and Prabhupada talking about even the conjugal affection here in the purport, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifying it also. But the same Shukadeva Goswami in the second canto, you know, he is condemning. He is saying, Deha apatya kalatra adishu atma senneshu asat swapi tesham pramatto nidhanam pashyanapina pashyati. Same Shukadeva Goswami, the same parental affection is there. So that is apatya, that parental affection is there. And kalatra is wife. So again the conjugal affection is there. And he is completely condemning that in the second canto. But here he is actually, suddenly he stops the main story and is glorifying the affection and the parental affection of the gopis. So why is it so? So obviously, I mean, one obvious reason is that anything that is devoted unto Krishna, you know, that is the best thing, that is the best utilization. The emotions are there in the heart, but when they are devoted to Krishna, you know, then you don't have to face the situation of nidhanam. What Shukadeva Goswami is saying, tesham pramato nidhanam. This, what is the meaning of nidhan? In local language, nidhan means death, right? But actually it is nidhanam, that means you lose all the wealth. Dhanam is wealth, and nidhanam means now you are become wealthless, right? So when a person dies, he loses all his wealth, right? And wealth is also categorized in so many different, there are different categories of wealth. Wealth does not only mean money. Like I remember one example, again Narayana Maharaj was giving an example. He said, just imagine that you have the entire wealth of the whole world, right? The whole world belongs to you. All the gold mines, all the oceans and the pearls underneath, all the rivers and the diamonds underneath, and everything, all the flora and fauna and animals, they, you know, everything belongs to you. But you are the only person in the whole world. And at that moment, you know, a small butterfly comes and it sits on your hand. You know, whom will you love more? Will you love that butterfly more, or you will love the entire world more? You will love the butterfly more, who has come and sit in your hand. So, the real wealth is actually in the facility of reciprocating some feelings, some relationship. That's the real wealth, you know. And those people who seek that wealth only in their children and in their wife, even that wealth also goes away when you die. But a devotee, because he is putting his wealth, because he is putting his emotions and feelings in Krishna and in devotees, you know, that continues. Even if he dies, so he never actually becomes nidhanam. He carries that wealth with him wherever he goes afterwards. But an ordinary person, so therefore Shukadeva Goswami is condemning that. that you have. But another thing which is very nice, which I felt, that this is really, and Prabhupada brings out that thing in the purport so nicely. You can understand the brilliance of Srila Prabhupada. Since in any relationship, now Prabhupada is talking about parent relationship. So in any relationship in Sanskrit is known as rasa, right? Because the relationship, there's a melo, there's a relationship melo, and that is known as a rasa. But the essence of relationship is known as sara, right? Like Krishna Skandha Goswami says, you know, jaya jaya ujvala rasa, sarva rasa sara. The essence is the most important and foundational aspect of a rasa. If you take out the essence, you know, sara, then everything is lost. Like in our Marathi language, you know, everything is also called as sara. Like sara kahi, sara vishwa, like that in Marathi they say. Sara kahi harum baslo. That means, you know, I lost everything. You know. So essence is actually everything. Once you take out essence, then whatever is lost, just imagine, you know, vanilla ice cream without vanilla essence. Who will eat it? It's just like a ball of cream. Someone may still eat it, but you know, it's but the essence is gone. Nobody can enjoy it. So the essence is everything actually. Why? Because that essence actually give rise to positive, genuine emotions. And Srila Prabhupada is pointing out that essence here in the purport. Any relationship is there, but what is, and not just parent relationship, any relationship, and Prabhupada is pointing out that essence. And what is that essence here? Prabhupada says, he says, but the offerings of devotees attached to Krishna in parental love are always sincere. A mother likes to offer something to the child with affection and love. There is no question of envy. This is the essence. In any relationship, when something is offered only out of love and there is no expectation of anything in return, when, of course, Prabhupada is saying here envy, that means any separate agenda. You have any relationship where there is some motivation behind, something is there behind, you know, it is a very uncomfortable situation. Like sometimes, you know, you are walking on a street and suddenly a person comes to you. He's actually wanting to ask you for some address, but he comes to you and mostly you feel that he's asking for some money only. So people don't even look at the person, they just go away. So excuse me, you know, I don't want to talk to you. Because as soon as there is the intuition that, you know, he's going to ask something from me, you just want to close the door, right? So any relationship where that agenda is there, that I want something from you, you just want to close the door. So this feeling of serving Krishna with pure affection, that is the essence. And when that essence is there, then that relationship becomes completely, so. And Srila, and here also he is glorifying, Prabhupada glorifying even the conjugal relationship and the parental relationship both. So this feeling of selflessness actually gives rise to a lot of positive emotions. So recently again we heard a story, Govind Prabhu narrated that story in the program. I like the story very much, and you can actually understand that how, you know, even the greatest complex situations in life can be easily resolved when you just do something that will invoke a positive emotion, because that is the essence of a relationship. So I will just, it's a nice story, I personally liked it very much, so I would just like to narrate. All of you may be already knowing it, the story of Pariyar flower. So, you know, the first time when Indra sent Narad Muni to invite Lord Krishna, Krishna was in Dwarka, to come, you know, so to attend a sacrifice, and he sent Narad Muni. Narad Muni was carrying a Pariyar flower with him, and the Pariyar flower was so fragrant. And as it is Narad Muni, he is, you know, transcendental. He, as it is fragrant, along with that Pariyar flower also, he came in the palace of Dwarka with Pariyar flower, and then the whole atmosphere was just imbued with so much of wonderful, wonderful smell. So he came, and then Krishna accepted the invitation. So Narad Muni said, okay, now whom should I offer this Pariyar flower? So Krishna said, okay, give it to Rukmini Devi. She is the representative of all the queens. You give it to her. So Krishna gave it to Rukmini Devi. And then, you know, Narad Muni, the way he is, he always likes to, you know, intensify the rasas wherever he has. So from there, he straight away went to the palace of Satyabhama. And Satyabhama, he saw Narad Muni. Even before she welcomed, she said, you know, why you're smelling so nice? It's beautiful. You're smelling extraordinarily nice. What is it? He said, no, you know, I was having a Pariyat flower with me. That's why. So, where is that flower? I gave it to Satyabhama. Why Satyabhama? Your husband only told me to give it to her. So Satyabhama very, very disturbed. So gave it to Rukmini, he said. So she came to Krishna. I said, Krishna, what is this? You know, you something best came and you gave it to Rukmini. You know what? I don't have it. So Krishna said, okay, forget about one flower. I'll give you a whole tree. You know, what to speak of flower? You know, Krishna can make such promises. You know, so you can't promise like that. And when actually Krishna went to... So actually when Krishna went to Indra's abode, you know, he killed Bana, Narkasur demon, he took the earrings of Aditi, he went and he returned, he did all that work. And then when he went to garden, you know, Satyabhama showed, hey, see, this is the Pariyat tree. You promised me. He said, yeah, don't worry, I'll take it. And Krishna just took the tree, you know. So typically, you know, if person like you and me, you know, you've given a promise and you go and your wife says, hey, you know, please take this for me. You know, take this tree for me. You may say, hey, I forgot the saw at home. You know, I couldn't carry my saw. I didn't carry my chakra. So Krishna says something, he has to do it. You know, it's a very nice story. I'll just little bit deflect from the topic. But it's so nice that Krishna, whatever he desires, he can immediately fulfill it. You know, that is this, when he says that he will do it, he does it. Because there are so many energies working constantly. Their energies are desperate to serve him. Now I was hearing this pastime of, what is that Leela? Krishna, he opened his mouth and Krishna eating dirt, right? So I used to, Mother Yashoda's pastime. So I used to always feel that Krishna initially showed the entire universe to Mother Yashoda in his mouth. And then later on he realized, oh, Mother Yashoda is actually getting affected by, you know, the Aishwarya potency and she is actually having that awe and reverence for me. So let me close my mouth and again smile and cover her. So obviously you feel that, you know she is going to feel awe and reverence, and why do you even show like that to her first? You are opening your mouth. Why you are showing Vishwarup Darshan first if she is going to be affected by the Aishwarya Shakti? You know that, right? You are supreme all knower. And then again closing your mouth and smiling and again, you know, removing that, you can't play with people like that, right? So why are you doing like this? But the acharyas explain. So actually when Krishna ate dirt and Yashoda Mai was there, she took a stick in hand. And she says, open your mouth, open your mouth. And Krishna was actually scared. He was actually scared, right? So, you know, sometimes in a house, if there's a tough fight between the mother and the son, you know, so the wife of the son, she comes and she tries to cover up the matter. You know, she will not offend the mother, but she will try to come up and cover up something, and you know, she may speak something so that the mother's anger is cooling down. So as this Mother Yashoda was getting angry on Krishna, you know, Krishna's Aishwarya Shakti, she kind of became uncomfortable. Says, this lady, you know, she is going to now, if Krishna opens his mouth and she sees the dirt inside, my God, what will happen to my Lord Krishna? So Aishwarya Shakti came in the middle. And she saw, she said, my dear Yashoda Devi, you know, you think that this small boy is your son. Now I will remove the illusion actually. Let me show you who this personality is. And then there was the entire universe in his mouth. And actually it is mentioned that Yashoda Mai saw the entire universe in his mouth. It's not like, you know, sometimes in computer we have the scroll, right? Scroll button. Like the whole thing is there. Everything is not covered in the screen. So you scroll down and then... So she didn't have to scroll down to see the whole universe like that. The whole universe was there. So it is inconceivable actually. When I first heard the pastime, I felt that something like scrolling concept will be there, you know. You scroll down and then you see the whole universe, okay. Scroll down, then see Earth also. Scroll down more, then zoom in. And then zoom in, you see Yashoda Mai inside. Not like that. She saw the entire whole universe with herself right in the mouth. No scrolling, no zooming. And that's, and she said, oh, what is this? Then she started becoming, you know, started becoming philosophical. Oh, I am just a small woman. I think that I am a queen. And Krishna must be thinking, you know, why is she not angry at me anymore? She actually was supposed to scold me. What is happening? Oh, my Aishwarya Shakti is playing a role. Fight. Close his mouth. And then again give a nice smile. Aishwarya Mai, forgot all that.
So Krishna didn't even tell Ashwatthama Shakti that you do something like this for me. On her own. So Prabhupada says this is the quality of Parasya Shaktir Vividhaiva Shruyate. So many potencies are just working on Krishna. He doesn't have to do anything. Therefore, when Krishna promises something, I will do it for you. There is no question about it. Therefore, even in deity worship, when we leave, you know, there is a shloka that we read, you know. What is that? You have promised Name Bhakta Pranashyati. What is that shloka? Pratigya Tavo Govinda Name Bhakta Pranashyati. It is samsmrutya samsmrutya pranan sandharayamyam. No, I am sustaining my life, Krishna, because you have prayed. You have said, and because you have said it, you know, I know all your energies are going to make it possible. You don't even have to do it personally. They will do it. Therefore, when we are dealing with Krishna, you know, we should be aware that all the energies are also there. You know, you may want to go and mess with him something, and you know, some energy will just pick you up and throw you away somewhere. You will not even realize. You know, Krishna may have to tell the energy, hey, don't do it. Right? So, you have to be very careful. All of them are there. Lakshmi sahasra shata sambrahma sevyamanam. They are all serving him constantly. Like that. So, Krishna said that I will take this tree. It was not a difficult task. He just took the tree, put it on the Garuda's back, and then flew down. And then he planted the tree in the courtyard of Satyabhama. Now, a tree, another thing, again, Prabhuji shared that. I have a few blessings, the other eyes share it. Wonderful point, I liked it. This tree came, it came from heavenly planets and is planted on earth. You know, what are the chances that it will grow nicely? Now forget about heavenly planet. If you put a tree from Kashmir and put it in Bombay, it will not grow. And you put a tree from Bombay and you take it to California, it may not grow. Or maybe take it to London, it will not grow. It's not possible. Even on earth, something coming from a heavenly planet and being planted here, but the tree was glowing nicely, flourishing. Why? Because every day the glances of Satyabhama, the glances of Krishna was falling on the tree. Just these glances were nourishing the tree. So what is the sign of prosperity in the material world? The sign of prosperity is that when Krishna is having loving glances upon you constantly. Therefore, Bhakti Sanswari Thakur said that, you know, don't try to see God. Serve God in such a way that He wants to see you, that He is happy to see you. Therefore, even cow protection. Srila Prabhupada writes in Krishna book. Prabhupada says the secret of prosperity is cow protection. You just maintain, and irrespective of whether it's an Indian cow or American cow, whichever cow. Cow is a cow. If you just protect her nicely, if you sustain, then you get loving glances of Krishna. And when loving glances of Krishna are coming, the prosperity has to come. You can't take it away. So the tree was flourishing nicely, it was growing. But what happened is, you know, because typically when a tree has a lot of flowers and fruits, it bends because of its weight. So the tree, although it was in the courtyard of Satyabhama, it was bending in the courtyard of Rukmini Devi only. Like that. So, you know, Satyabhama saw that. And even a nice breeze would come, all the flowers would fall in Rukmini's courtyard. So, Satyabhama saw that. He said, Krishna, see, again, you are, everything you do is strategic. You know, you are too strategic in your life. This is your strategy that you put the tree in such a place that the flowers will go. And she again became very angry. And then what Krishna said was something very nice. Krishna said, he did not argue with her. He said, Satyabhama, he said, just try to understand who are you. He said, you are Bhumi Devi. You are expansion of Bhumi Devi. And who is Mother Earth? He says, Mother Earth is a person who keeps on producing and producing and producing, and other people enjoy at her cost. That's what Mother Earth does, right? People dig tunnels in her, people dig so many holes for mining, people, you know, do so much of excavation, so much of nuclear waste is thrown, so much of, we actually do absolute atrocity with Mother Earth, but still she keeps giving. We put all chemical fertilizers inside, so many things. But she simply keeps giving and giving and giving, and others enjoy. He said, your nature is like that, Satyabhama. So therefore this tree, because your nature is giving, this tree is going in your courtyard, but because your constitutional nature is like that, you know, you are just wanting others to enjoy. And as soon as Krishna said that, that invoked the positive emotion in her heart. So this is the essence of all relationship. As soon as the essence of selfless love, simplicity, humility, you know, whenever these things are seen, they invoke tremendous positive emotions in the heart of a person. And that transforms the heart. Immediately she was pacified.
You know, sometimes I don't know, some those of you who have been working in offices, and you know, they typically ask this question in the interview also. Sometimes you have conflicts with the colleagues. You know, how will you handle the situation? You know, sometimes you're having conflict with the boss. How will you handle the situation? This is the way you handle the situation. Everything is given in scriptures. Just speak something which will invoke a positive sentiment in the heart of the person. Glorify the person for what he is. Give him the credit for what he's doing. Find out that selflessness. That selflessness is there in the heart of every person. So why even in this, I was discussing about Dehapatya Karatra Dishu, right? Shukadeva Goswami is criticizing that. He's saying that when you love your children, you naturally have that selfless quality to serve your child, right? You have the selfless quality. Like recently, one devotee was sharing with me. He's a disciple of His Holiness Mahanidhi Swami Maharaj. And some years before, they had a child. So after they had a child, he said, after my child was born, he said, my wife was 24/7 with the child. Everything she was doing, she wouldn't sleep sometimes, you know, she would not take proper rest, just 24/7 serving the child. The only thing probably she did different than taking care of a child was her 16 rounds of chanting Hare Krishna, that's all. Everything was simply for the child. So he went to his spiritual master, Mahanidhi Swami Maharaj, and he said, you know, this is what my wife is doing. She doesn't have time to read anything, he said, that is perfect. He said, she is actually getting trained in Rasa Bhakti, 24/7. Only thing, right now the child is there. When the child grows up at a particular type of time, just add Krishna there also. Just add Krishna also there. You are already trained up in 24/7 service now, after having a child. You stay awake in the night, like sometimes we hear in the lectures, right? All night kirtans. You know, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would do all night kirtans. I would always amazed at how can you do all night kirtans? I remember one time, there was actually we had with Gaurapurnima festival in Kirtan went till 11 o'clock or 11:30. And then every time Radhananda Maharaj would stop, they would say Hari Bol, and again the Kirtan would go on, You know, I am not a person who is, I started becoming a little uncomfortable because I said, Abhi kitna chalega? I also didn't feel like going out. And then after the whole thing was over, you know, suddenly all Brahmacharis surrounded Maharaj, and one Brahmachari said, Maharaj, we should have all night Kirtan. I will not be able to do it. Sorry. You know, but after my daughter was born, I understood what is all night Kirtan. I completely understood what is all night Kirtan. And there is no choice. You know. So you can't, there's all night Kirtan happening, man, everything. I mean, it may have Hare Krishna, may not have Hare Krishna Mahamantra in it. But it's the all night Kirtan reciprocation of love. It's Prem Sankirtan actually. In one sense. It's all night Prem Sankirtan going on. So he said, you're already getting trained in Rasa Bhakti. Just at proper time, add Krishna to it. And it's 24/7. Right? So, we should know where to invest what. You know, if you want to invest your heart, you know, Krishna is the best place. You know, you should know where to invest. Otherwise, if you don't invest in the right place, what will happen? You know, you may get lost. So, this is another wonderful point that he was sharing, that, you know, people go to demigods and they actually want to offer their heart. But right in the same story, actually, when Krishna picked up the Pariyat flower, what happened? Pariyat tree. Indra became very angry. He's a demigod. So Krishna, I sent you one Pariyat flower as an invitation. That is my courtesy. If you want more, then, you know, you have to fight a war with me. Can you imagine? And Indra actually declared a war. He had just been completely humbled in Govardhan pastime, probably not few days back, because the time in the material world, in earth, is much slower than the time in the, much faster than time in the spiritual world. Here it might have passed 10, 15 years, but there it may be just few hours passed. So few hours you have been humbled, and again, you know, you want to declare war. So the problem with demigods is, they are very calculative. Okay, you do so much, I will give you this much only, more. If you want more, then, you know, I don't have. That is not possible. But with Krishna, you give him something, you know, he gives his whole himself to you. So when you put your heart, when you put heart in Krishna, Krishna put his heart in you. That's what, you know, sadhunam hrudayam mayam, sadhunam hrudayam tuham. Madanyatanyat. Why he's saying like that? Because you give him your heart,
He puts his heart in you. Whole self. So he may say, you know, in Bhagavad Gita, you may say, "Are, but Krishna says, Yathamam prapadyante tam satayo bhajamyam." Krishna is saying like that. So he is also calculative. He is saying that as you surrender only, I will reciprocate with you. But even that Yathamam prapadyante, you know, he is saying, there is a difference. Giving an example, for example, suppose if I, suppose there is a job of say, let's say a technical, some kind of a software developer, let's say. And say there are chotu companies there, just coming up in the market, you know, and that company puts advertisement, okay, we want a software developer, experience 7 years, salary, market standard. And a huge, big multinational MNC company, maybe a big investment bank, of course, now all investment banks are having problem, but some big company, he says that, okay, software developer required, experience 7 years, salary, market standard. Right? So their market standard is different than their market standard. So he may give something calculative to you, and he may give something calculative, but that calculativeness is completely different. That's what here we are talking about. Why Shukadeva Goswami is so excited about this pastime? Putana came to kill Krishna, feed poison to him, and what she got? Position of mother in the spiritual world. Even in Bhagavad Gita, you know, Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, it's quite amazing. A person who has fallen from the path of devotional service. Just imagine. A person who has, he has begun Krishna consciousness, you know, sometimes you see, you know, devotees come and they get inspired, they dance enthusiastically, and then, you know, some brahmachari comes, takes some phone number, Prabhuji, aapka phone number, okay, take the phone number, or Chetna or Prerana festival, take some phone numbers. And then the person is calling, Prabhuji, aaj Chetna festival, I'll come. He doesn't turn up. Second Chetna, Prerana festival. He is not supposed to come for Chetna anyways. Sorry. So, because Prabhuji, Prerana, please, can you come for Prerana? No. Like one time my friend was there, you know, I called him, Prabhuji, can you please come to temple? We have a lecture. No, aaj maine anda khaya, I can't come. I said, so okay. It doesn't matter what you eat and you know why. So people don't come. They come for some time, they chant, and when the parents come to know at home, the parents say, "Kya kar raha hai? Bahut zyada hi thoda idhar udhar ja raha hai." And they just say that, "Please come back." And they, such a person, Krishna says, takes birth in the house of a rich family. So where is the Yathamam Prapadyante principle here? So Krishna, Yathamam Prapadyante of Krishna also, if you have served him for six days, Krishna put you in the house of a rich family in next life. Why? So Krishna feels that, okay, you got so many distractions, because of which you went back, okay, now enjoy them, but then come back to me. It's like you join a company and within 1 month you leave the job. And the person says, okay, I will give you whole life pension and plus, you know, I will give you promotion also for serving for 6 days. Which company, which employer will do like this? So Krishna, Yathamam Prapadyante also, I mean, I need to understand the Yathamam Prapadyante fully. It's not really Yathamam Prapadyante. He is just giving much, much more than what you can do. So that is the place where you should invest. So when you invest in Krishna, there is no question of Nidhanam. Nidhanam does not happen. Nidhanam happens if you put any your money or your heart in any other place than Krishna. Then the Nidhanam takes place. So here it doesn't happen. So this, I don't know, I probably got distracted. So this positive sentiment which is there, that Krishna has. Now Krishna is teaching us how to use the positive, because that is the place where you invest that in Krishna, and then you are the wealthiest person. And you see later on also this wonderful pastime of Srila Prabhupada. The Srila Prabhupada was actually, you know, they were doing Jagannath Baldev Subhadra Ratha Yatra, and Shyam Sundar Prabhu, I believe, he was actually carving the deity of Jagannath Baldev Ji, and then he was painting. And when Prabhupada came there, you know, Prabhupada saw that a box of cigarette on the head of Baldevji, like a box. So Prabhupada did not chastise Shyam Sundar Prabhu. And Prabhupada just took that box and he said, "Why do you want an insignificant cigarette between you and Krishna?" And as soon as Prabhupada said that, that gave him so much of positive emotion, from that onwards he left cigarette completely. Never had it. So this aspect of giving, you know, a person that positive emotion in the heart, that is the trick. That is the trick by which you can solve all the problems in life. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also, see his life, he actually used this same trick. with Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, he used the same trick. And mostly with Prakashananda Saraswati. I love this pastime. This Prakashananda Saraswati was a hardcore Mayavadi person. He was actually a Brahmavadi. People say he actually had Brahman realization. Hardcore Mayavadi person. You know? How to penetrate such a person's heart? Just tell me. How can you penetrate? Can you argue with him? A scholar, Mayavadi? Can you? Nope, not. There's no way. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to attend that whole assembly. He did not even go and join them on the stage. He sat somewhere in the corner. And when Prakashananda Saraswati saw that, you know, this man, he's a sannyasi, such effulgent, so beautiful, so handsome, and he's sitting in a place where people wash their feet. So, you know, something went in his heart. So he got up, picked his hand, he said, "My dear sir, I have a question for you. So we are all sannyasis, you are a sannyasi, we study Vedanta Sutra. So why are you just simply chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra and not studying Vedanta?" Now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the same person as Nimai Pandit, don't forget that. And when he was a Nimai Pandit, he was a tough scholar to defeat. Big, even Kesho Kashmiri, directly blessed by Saraswati Devi, he could not defeat. Right? And probably Prakashananda Saraswati knew all this. Right? And he's asking a question like that. Now, if Mahaprabhu wanted to defeat him, it was like this for him. Nothing, no effort. I'm giving some compare. I was watching this martial arts. And you know, there was the people just fight and something like that. But then, in one movie I saw used in childhood, you know, when so there was a lot of fight going on, and one person fights, and he wins. A lot of fighting, then he wins. And then Bruce Lee comes with him. And then Bruce Lee just gives one kick and he's flat. So, because there's so much of power in that, there's so much of punch, there's so much of a mystic. You know, this art of Kung Fu, there's some kind of mysticism involved in it. They just, something like that. This one hoof is done, and it's not a punch, it's like the whole power of the universe is going there. Some kind of a mysticism. So Krishna, he may just speak one word, hook, and then, you know, finish. Prakashananda Saraswati doesn't have to do anything after that. But what he said, "My Guru Maharaj said that I am a fool. I am not qualified to chant. I am not qualified to study Vedanta. He just made me." When Mahaprabhu said that, Saraswati just melted out completely. There was nothing, nothing left in him. This same Nimai Pandit, who is like a Digvijay and he is a massive scholar, he can do miracles. He's saying, "I am a fool. I cannot." That invoked so much of positive emotion in the heart of a person. Then he became a susceptible. Then he could be preached to. Then Mahaprabhu preached to him. But initially, he invoked that positive sentiment. So therefore, the topics of emotions are not excluded from Srimad Bhagavatam. Because the right emotion expressed at right time, especially when there is this type of attitude of selflessness, of pure affection and love. Most of the disciples of Srila Prabhupada in early days, they would not understand Srila Prabhupada, what he would speak. He had a heavy Bengali accent, but they still kept coming to him and listening from him. Why? Because they understood one thing, that this old man is not going to cheat me. He is not going to cheat me. He is a genuine sadhu. So as soon as that feeling is there, that this person will not cheat me, there is a selfless, there is a only doing something only for the pleasure, it can be detected by the heart. And that is a positive emotion, and that, just from these positive emotions, you know, person's life can be completely transformed. So such topics are not excluded in Srimad Bhagavatam. So therefore a devotee actually should learn how at different places he can, and yeah, another thing, how can a devotee graduate himself to that level, that he can actually speak something and have the transformation and invoke genuine emotions in the heart of a person, you know. So the best way to do that, actually, like I was recently in Barsana also. Recently, we had went to Barsana for some devotional service. And I saw one thing there. The people who are there, we went to that house known as Rasmandir. And there are these few old ladies. They just keep cooking and serving whole day. They don't even come out of the kitchen sometimes. And so much of the amount of chapatis that they make, the amount of sabji that they make, just whole, there's a serving and serving and serving. Extreme level of service attitude. Right? And sometimes, you know, when you give something, you have some quota. You know, you always, like even in our serving sometimes, you go, you take a plate. And you know, devotee asks, second serving hai kya? In Vrindavan, you don't have to ask the question, second serving hai kya? It's by default there. If it finishes, it's finished. That's fine. Nobody cares if it gets over. Because there's just so much of selfless service. So, you know, how can you reach that level of selfless service? Because unless you have that selfless motivation, you cannot speak such words. You know? So therefore, there is a concept of reversibility. Those of you who have studied engineering, you know, there's something called as a reversible process. Reversible process means what? Like for example, in our scooter also, you know, you put petrol inside and the gas comes out, the carbon dioxide comes. But you cannot again take the carbon dioxide and put back and form a fuel out of it. It is not possible. Right? So it's irreversible. So in material world, the processes are irreversible. They cannot happen. All the formulas in classic thermodynamics, if you study, this may be not relevant to all of you, but if you study classic thermodynamics, all the formulas of process are based on the assumption that all processes are fully reversible. But they are not, so then they add some factors into it to compromise. But the basic assumption is all. Why the assumption is there? Because in spiritual world, the processes are fully reversible. Right? So if you have a lot of service, if you have a lot of devotion for Krishna in your heart is just overflowing with Krishna's devotion, then the obvious outcome that happens is there is selfless service attitude. But if you don't have that heart flowing with devotion for Krishna, you do selfless attitude, keep on doing that, one day your heart will overflow with devotion, sentiments for Krishna. Just do service attitude submissively, don't expect, keep on doing it, right? One day you will realize your heart is completely filled with Krishna's emotions. It is fully reversible process. And that's why the sadhana bhakti is there. A person who is on the raganuga stage may do the same things that all of us do, but do so much of love and taste. But we are not on raganuga stage, we do the same things, you can go back to raganuga stage. It's fully reversible. Right? So therefore, if we just have, and what actually it really means to have a proper service attitude. You know, I personally feel that from practical sense, you know, a proper service attitude means when a service is being offered to you, that Prabhuji, can you do this service? First of all, we should be very grateful. Should not look at the service as a burden, that, oh, okay, I am doing so many things, Varek, mere sar ke upar dal diya. First of all, being grateful. And then really evaluate in the core of the heart that do I really have enough time and assets to even stretch a little bit to do this? Rather than straight away saying, no, I can't do this. Can I stretch a little bit and can I do it? You know, be very honest. We can't be lazy for that. You have to be very honest. And if the answer comes, yes, you can do it, then take that service. What's the problem? Rather than just saying, sorry, Prabhuji, mere ko nahi jamega. Keep the phone down. Rather than just evaluate. Then maybe you can do a little bit of stretch. Maybe you can do a little bit of organization here. Prabhupada said, Krishna consciousness means two things. You know, sincerity and organization. Sankirtan, you need to have enthusiasm. Like somebody asked, Prabhupada asked, right, how would the ISKCON movement continue? And then Prabhupada, the disciple replied, Prabhupada, we just have to be sincere. Prabhupada said, only sincerity will not work. You have to be organized also. Because you are sincere and completely haphazard and spontaneous in your work. You are not organized. You are not going to achieve anything. Like Shamanambaru, I like this statement of Shamanambaru. He says, it is expensive to be inorganized. It is expensive to be inorganized in material life. Beautiful statement. So, we have to be organized. Just see, if I can be organized a bit, and can I do that service? Yes, I can do it. Then do that. That is all about service attitude. And once you do that service, one day, just by seeing your honesty and doing that service one day, you will realize that, you know, like that beautiful shloka, what is that? Yada yada gaura padara vinde, something that vindeta bhaktim kurta punya rashi tato tato, what is that? Yudhi akasmat radha padam bhuja sudhambu rashi. I don't remember which acharya is. Wonderful shloka. It's like the bhakti is like a provident fund, you know. It actually gets cut from your salary. It doesn't go in your hand. When you go, you know, provident fund gets cut from your salary and you say, are yaar, paisa hath mein bahut kam aaya. But then there is an employee's contribution and employer's contribution also. That you don't see. Right? So there is an employee's contribution happening in your salary. As a devotee, you have having a devotee contribution and then there is Krishna's contribution also happening. Which you won't see. And one day, Rudi Akasmat, one day you realize, oh, I have so much of fund with me. I never realized it. And Krishna says, you have so much of money, I'll take you with me. Just come with me. Because I also put so much when you are putting it. Right? So it's like that. That's how the reversible bhakti works. So therefore, we should just learn from, you know, these scriptures how to, you know, really deal in life, how to really stay in life, and then how to become successful. I just probably got distracted a lot of here and there, but I think that's all I had to say. Thank you very much, Hare Krishna. If anybody has any comments, questions, we can take. Okay. Srila Prabhupada ki. Srimad Bhagavatam ki. Ananta Koti Vaishnavanda ki.